Hello, my people. I wanted to look at the upcoming Marvel film, The Eternals. It's set to be released in theaters on Friday, the 5th of November, 2021. But it has already gotten a 59% Rotten Tomato critic score, the lowest of the MCU to date. Now, this ensemble film was directed by Oscar winner Chloe Zhao and stars Gemma Chan as Cersei, Richard Madden as Icarus, Angelina Jolie as Thena, Kit Harington as Dane Whitman, aka the Black Knight, Kumail Nanjiani as Kingo, Leah McHugh as Sprite, Brian Tyree Henry as Fastos, Lauren Ridloff as Makari, Barry Keoghan as Druig, Ma Dong Seok as Gilgamesh, Harish Patel as Quran. Now, of course, this movie is based on the great Jack Kirby comic title of the same name, King Kirby! So let's do a little history of the series of events that led to Kirby writing it, because I kind of find this interesting as well. Afterwards, we'll look at some of the reasons for the low Rotten Tomato score. Is this a case of go woke, go broke, or are there other factors at play? And we'll determine if this is really a review bomb. Now, according to the internets, King Kirby had left Marvel Comics to work for their competition. Now, there's a lot of rumors on why this happened, but a lot of them point to the fact that him and Stan Lee may have had a falling out. Now, DC gave Kirby complete creative control, and he wrote the legendary Fourth World Saga. Now, this included the New Gods, with such characters as Orion, the High Father, Mr. Miracle, and of course, DC's favorite big bad, Darkseid. Nowadays, we are so familiar with the concepts that we almost take it for granted, but in the early 70s, this was pretty groundbreaking. It had a mix of conflict among gods, but it was rooted in a sci-fi setting. With Orion, we see a hero that is the son of the enemy in Darkseid, but fights against him. This is the same theme that we see illustrated with Luke Skywalker of Star Wars. Now, as groundbreaking as the Fourth World title was, it was kind of unpopular for the time. Unfortunately, this led to DC canceling the series before Kirby could finish his story. Some comic historians feel that this is one of the greatest tragedies in comicdom. Shortly afterwards, Kirby returned to the same company that he had contributed so much of his talent. He came back to his home at Marvel Comics. This gave Kirby a chance to at least thematically finish the story that he had begun in DC Comics. So this is the publication history of The Eternals, at least as best as I understand it. The storyline revolves around a group of giant space gods known as the Celestials, and they're running giant science experiments all over the universe. The early Earth was also a planet that the Celestials had messed with. This resulted in three different races taking shape on our planet. In no particular order, I'll go through them. We have the Deviants, who are very bad and very powerful due to having unchecked mutations. They're also pretty unstable as well. Then we have the Eternals, which are a sort of angelic-like protectors of the Celestials' interests. Now, both the Eternals and the Deviants can tap into cosmic power to some degree. The Eternals are better at it because they can tap into the power directly. The third group is basically modern-day humans. Now, some of them were given a latent gene that would manifest much later in humanity. Now, this latent gene sounds a lot like the X gene of the mutant population, and it is. but it is also an explanation for a lot of the Marvel superheroes. Like Steve Rogers had this gene, and he was able to absorb Vita rays. Same thing with Bruce Banner. He was exposed to gamma rays, and he turned into the Incredible Hulk. Now, in the real world, radiation exposure would probably just kill you, but for them, it turned them into heroes, and this latent gene was the explanation for it. In regards to the Eternals, they just kind of start to blend in with humanity, kind of keeping themselves separate, but they end up becoming the basis of a lot of myth and folklore, and in some cases, the basis of either gods or heroic figures. Sometimes the Celestials would drop by and they'd be kind of disappointed by the fact that the Eternals weren't doing what they were told. They weren't really protecting the Celestial interests like they wanted. The Eternals are immortal, as their title suggests, and they are very powerful. This is pretty evident with Icarus being compared to Superman in the Eternals trailer, which is kind of insane. So, we got through the history of the publication and a brief introduction into their backstory. Now let's look at the importance of the Eternals into the MCU. I'm guessing that Kevin Feige hopes for similar success that Guardians of the Galaxy had. Now this is a closest comparison I can think of because both Guardians and Eternals are not common knowledge for non-comic book fans. Also, I'm the casual comic fan and I had to research a bit of stuff before doing this video. Now, the advantage of this is this gives them a chance to build a new superhero team from relatively unknown characters. For this franchise, they went with a very talented and Oscar-winning Chloe Zhao to direct. Now, Chloe has a very interesting filmography. She's known for the 2015 film Songs My Brother Taught Me, 2017's The Rider, and the critically acclaimed and Oscar-winning 2020 film Nomadland. Now to date, The Eternals will be the biggest movie that Zhao has directed. The MCU has also taken the opportunity to display even more diversity in this film, with race, gender, and especially with the LGBTQ community. This is most evident with the character of Fastos. This Eternal is in a long-term relationship with a man, and they're raising a child together. Now, this is at the heart of the claim of the review bombing argument for the Rotten Tomatoes rating. There are already claims that this is just another example of Hollywood wokeness. What's interesting is usually review bombing comes from the audience score. These reviews are based on critic scores. Now, I don't know what the requirements are for being considered a film critic. Heck, I just reviewed a film recently. This has no real importance on the video, but check out my review of the DC animated Injustice movie if you get a chance. Now, I don't doubt that once the audience score hits on Rotten Tomato, the wokeness is probably going to be called out. But at the moment, this isn't the case. And again, it's completely from critical reviews. And the critical reviews don't really point out diversity as being the problem for the movie itself. Let us look at a few of them. Barry Hertz from Globe and Mail says, Zhao is a baffling choice, a filmmaker who is ill-equipped and out of her element, with her discomfort visible across nearly every frame of the film. Yikes. Mick LaSalle from the San Francisco Chronicle says, it takes a special kind of movie anti-magic to make an entire audience indifferent to the potential destruction of the planet and the elimination of all life and Earth. Eternals manages that. Now that's really kind of saying something because this is from the San Francisco Chronicle, and San Francisco is just about as liberal as you get, so, huh. Kay Austin Collins from Rolling Stone says, Eternals is so busy showing off what they can do, where it can go, that it bypasses and overlooks what it really has to offer. There are some real dilemmas, real battles buried beneath the soft-pedaled, naturally lit, cozy surfaces of the movie. Now, of course, there are some positive reviews, like Maura McDonald of the Seattle Times. She says it's a different kind of superhero movie. Not to everyone's taste, but made for us all. Nell Minow of Movie Mom says, I'm sorry to tell you this, but this movie is a mess. Seriously, this is actually a positive review. She gives the movie a B-. Nina Lee Coombs from the Chicago Reader says, its ambiguity, the attention to a person's capacity for contradiction and change, that sets Zhao's MCU debut apart. Now, even the positive reviews of the movies aren't completely complimentary of the film. More like, it's interesting, and I love Chloe Zhao. At least, that's the takeaway I'm getting from it. What's amazing is this is a really good first example of Kevin Feige and the MCU at large having a misstep. This is even more baffling with the great success of Shang-Chi, Legend of the Ten Rings, that preceded this movie. My suspicion is that Marvel will blame the audience for the low scores, much like they did with The Last Jedi. Not Marvel, but Lucasfilm did that. But the key difference between the two films is The Last Jedi had high critical scores for some reason. I wouldn't be entirely surprised if the term man baby makes a return. Now, I love representation and I want everybody to have it. If members of the LGBTQ community identify with Fastos and his husband, I think that would be awesome. But representation may not be the source of the problem for this Marvel film. Chloe Zhao is an interesting choice to direct the movie. I suspect that Marvel has rolled the dice and won so many times that it was a foregone conclusion that the movie would turn out great. The opinion was probably even more cemented when Chloe won Best Picture and Best Director for Nomadland. But the question is, did she understand Jack Kirby? Personally, I don't know. And I don't even know if that was something that the critics were asking either. But it was probably something Kevin Feige should have asked. But I haven't seen the film yet, and it's possible that all the critics are wrong. I'll keep an open mind, and I'll see if I enjoy it. But of course, that's my opinion, and I'd love to hear yours. Do you think this movie will be good? Or do you think it's too woke? Or do you think it's just not going to be a great movie? Feel free to leave your comment. As always, fare thee well, my friends, and take care. Ooh, one last thing. I still want interactivity in my channel, so if there's a subject that you think I should cover, feel free to comment. I would love to have suggestions. All right. Fare thee well. Take care.